We all love a good dive watch. They are rugged, dependable, and nowadays are ubiquitous everywhere we go. They are the bread and butter to all of us who appreciate watches, but also to those who know nothing about them. And the truth is that the majority of these dive watches are overkill. They have been made to withstand any kind of abuse, but their owners never could or would exploit them to that degree. There is this great stigma around the idea that sports watches we buy, whether luxury or otherwise, are delicate instruments. I watch too many channels that fear that submerging a submersible watch will destroy their seals because of what they've heard through the media, fearing that taking their sports watches out into the rain, whether they have screw-down crowns or not, will damage them, and instead keep them safely stowed away in Pelican cases, in a safe or in a cupboard, polishing them with fiber cloths every night before bed. Simply put, modern watches have come a long way over the last few decades, and your watch can take a lot more punishment than you think it can. A dive watch without a scratch is sacrilege in my book. Take from that what you like. And to explain my point further, let's look at the development of the grandest Rolex dive watch. So we have the Submariner, a top-performing sports car. Let's call it a Porsche 911 Turbo, a perfect watch for everyday use, but something that is also stock standard. Beside it, we have the Sea-Dweller. Let's call this watch the 911 GT3 RS, a perfect watch for everyday use, but with an added performance package for extra fun in the sun. Most dive watch fans know the history of the Sea-Dweller by now, but I will fill you in on it briefly. It was designed with the intention of going to greater depths than the standard Submariner. It needed the introduction of a release valve to help remove the watch of excess helium gas molecules as they expanded when the diver moved between extreme depths and pressures. The excess helium, as it expanded, would blow the crystals from the commercial Submariners. And so Rolex collaborated with Comex, a French commercial diving company, to create the ultimate diving instrument. What resulted after the initial prototypes was the reference 1665 for the commercial market. It was a beauty. There is something about this watch that makes the first Sea-Dwellers so fascinating to me. They were thin, sleek, and elegant. They were not in your face or ostentatious. They remained the same 39mm size, with a minor increase in the case thickness for the small valve that was neatly tucked away on the side. But really, the greatest visual change on the watch was the large domed acrylic crystal. That's it. The watch had the same plain Jane appearance of the 5513 Submariners of the time, but could travel twice the depth. The watch looks like a standard 911 Turbo from the outside, but has the performance package and all the bells and whistles on the inside. It is a sleeper, a discreet bragging right. Then we move on through the years until the arrival of the infamous 1660, known as the 666, that then developed into the 16600. And this watch to me, even at this point in time, is the ultimate Sea-Dweller. I would even venture so far to say that this is one of the most beautiful Submariners ever made, let alone Sea-Dwellers, because it is understatement personified. It remains the same diameter of a Submariner cousin, but again has a thicker case and a thicker crystal. A true tool watch that is so refined, so simple and unassuming, but all the while outperforms any of the standard watches in its genre. The watch that came after it is broadly loved by the community. The first edition of the ceramic bezel Sea-Dweller, the 116600, and this was the final hurrah and swan song to the traditional Sea-Dweller line. A beautiful watch. And now to the pieces that came after it. Love me or hate me, but I find them to be a problem, at least when looking at their developmental timeline. The Great Departure, a watch that historically has always been 40mm, now sits in the realms of 43 and 44mm. It has gone beyond overkill, and let me explain. Modern Rolex no longer focuses on understatement with their watches. This tectonic shift has turned a lot of people away from the brand, and many are happy that they still own the older reference pieces for that reason. There is no better example of this change than when we look at the Sea-Dweller line. The concept of the Sea-Dweller has always been overkill, creating a watch that can go to ridiculous depths, and it is a novelty for anyone, since even professional saturation divers don't travel to those depths. But never until this point in time did Rolex ever need to visually advertise how excessive their dive watches were. The 44mm James Cameron Deep Sea. I admire anyone who could wear a watch like this daily without experiencing any kind of osteoarthritis down the line. Yes, it is a watch that basically stems from a prototype, and the thought process and execution was excellent for a novelty, a watch that can go to depths exceeding 4 kilometers under the sea. And the use of the colors on this watch is gorgeous. It has to have one of the best dials in their catalogue. I am all for technological advancement, and this watch is a marvel, but that is where the watch should have stopped. It could have been the one model that remained that size and stood out proudly as a statement. But the method of increasing the watch's size has now seeped into the new 50th anniversary Sea-Dweller line. This watch could be considered a revival and restarted the line after a few years of absence. The model built on the foundations of the deep sea and is fatter, thicker, and tries to save itself by adding a line of red text to its name that appeals to enthusiasts, but then shoots itself in the foot by adding a cyclops to the crystal. Yes, they have the glue and the capabilities of securing a cyclops to the glass now. That is not the point. It is just another example that goes against the grain of what the Sea-Dweller was all about. If you haven't taken the hint yet, the design of the new Sea-Dweller bothers me. It has ever since it was released, because essentially all it offers is a larger area of wasted space on the dial. There is no need to increase the size and the thickness other than making it look overbuilt, since the watch performs just the same as previous generations of Sea-Dwellers. It can handle the same pressures and go to the same depths, so if size is unnecessary for purpose, what is the point of it? And I agree that the size increase visually differentiates the watch from the Submariner, but I believe that Rolex had a winning formula with the first ceramic generation of the 116600. All that needed to be done would have been to include the red text on the dial and play around with the proportions, maybe add a thicker crystal for visual difference. I have explained my reasoning a few months ago about why the supercase was introduced to the Submariner line, and I also mentioned that it was a smart move for Rolex. Increase the size of the case, but leave the diameter of the watch the same. What this does is cater for a larger audience with bigger wrists, but does not completely alienate others who have smaller wrists. It is a watch better suited for more people. So Rolex have always been focused on the advancement of their pieces and aim to procedurally improve them. The Sea-Dweller for over 30 years has been a model about refinement, but also understatement, being able to perform unlike any other while being a wolf in sheep's clothing. So what is the point of making a watch look all the more ostentatious? Is it all for clout? Now many of you will disagree about my thoughts on the modern Sea-Dwellers, and I understand that. I'm sure many of you own them. And let's not kid ourselves, they are terrific watches. They cater for people who have bigger wrists and are larger for the sake of legibility. Some will buy these new Sea-Dwellers because they believe the pieces can hold up more and take more abuse than the standard Submariner ever will. And I think that aspect has a part to play with the visual identity of these newer watches. Aesthetically, they look tough. But the reality is, even the five-digit references with aluminium bezels and rattly bracelets are extremely hard-wearing watches. Look at the original four-digit references, the likes of the 5512 and the 5513. Even their ancestors are around today after decades of a hard, abusive life. Look at the original Comex dive watches, actively used for decades and still look bulletproof. The Sea-Dweller has, for the longest time, been a discreet bragging right, a novelty for the wearer to one-up the Submariner wearer. There is something cool about a watch that can travel beyond the depths that would kill the wearer, but equally, advertising its bravado is unnecessary. And with the lineup of such elegant watches that came before it, to me, the new Sea-Dwellers are just begging for your attention.